Alerans. Furies of Calderon by Jim Butcher. Read by Kate Redding. Prologue. The course of history is determined not by battles, by sieges or usurpations, but by the actions of the individual. The strongest city, the largest army, is, at its most basic level, a collection of individuals. Their decisions, their passions, their foolishness, and their dreams shape the years to come. If there is any lesson to be learned from history, it is that all too often the fate of armies, of cities, of entire realms, rests upon the actions of one person. In that dire moment of uncertainty, that person's decision, good or bad, right or wrong, big or small, can unwittingly change the world. But history can be quite the slattern. One never knows who that person is, where he might be, or what decision he might make. It is almost enough to make me believe in destiny. From the writings of Gaius Primus, First Lord of Alera.
"Please, Tavi,"
wheedled the girl in the pre-dawn darkness outside the Steadholt's kitchen.
"Just this one little favour."
"I don't know," said the boy. "There's so much work today."
She leaned in closer to him, and the boy felt her slender body mould against his, soft and flower-scented and delightful. She pressed her mouth to his cheek in a slow kiss and whispered in his ear,
"I'd be very grateful."
"Well," the boy said, "I'm not sure if,
She kissed his cheek again and whispered,
"Please."
His heart pounded more quickly and his knees felt weak.
"All right, I'll do it."
Chapter 1. Amara rode atop the swaying back of the towering old gargant bull, going over the plan in her head. The morning sun shone down on her, taking the chill out of the misty air and warming the dark wool of her skirts. Behind her, the axles of the cart squeaked and groaned beneath their loads. The slave collar she wore had begun to chafe her skin, and she made an irritated mental note to wear one for a few days in order to grow used to it before the next mission. Assuming she survived this one, of course. A tremor of nervous fear ran down her spine and made her shoulders tighten. Amara took a deep breath and blew it out again, closing her eyes for a moment and blocking out every thought except for the sensations around her. Sunlight on her face, swaying of the pungent gargant's long strides, creaking of the cart's axles.
"Nervous?" asked the man walking beside the gargant.
A goad dangled from his hand, but he hadn't lifted it in the entire trip. He managed the beast with the lead straps alone, though his head barely came to the old bull's brown-furred thigh. He wore the plain clothes of a peddler, brown leggings, sturdy sandals, with a padded jacket over his shirt, dark green on homespun. A long cape, tattered green without embroidery, had been cast over one shoulder as the sun rose higher. "No," Amara lied. She opened her eyes again, staring ahead. Fidelius chuckled.
"Liar. It's not a brainless plan. It might work."
Amara shot her teacher a wary glance. "But you have a suggestion?"
"In your graduation exercise?" Fidelius asked. "Crows, no. I wouldn't dream of it, Academ. It would cheapen your performance."
Amara licked her lips. "But you think that there's something I should know?" Fidelius gave her a perfectly guileless look.
"I did have a few questions."
"Questions," Amara said. "We're going to be there in a few moments."
"I can ask them when we arrive, if you prefer."
"If you weren't my Patroceras, I would find you an impossible man," Amara sighed.
"That's sweet of you to say," Fidelius replied. You've come a long way since your first term at the Academy. You were so shocked when you found out that the cursors did more than deliver missives.
You love telling that story, even though you know I hate it.
No, Fidelius said with a grin. I love telling that story because I know you hate it.
She looked down at him archly. This is why the cursor legate keeps sending you away on missions, I think.
It's a part of my charm, Fidelius agreed. Now then, my first concern...
Question,
Amara corrected. Question, he allowed. Is with our cover story.
What question? Armies need iron. You're an ore smuggler and I'm your slave. You heard there was a market out this way and you came to see what money could be made.
Ah, said Fidelius. And what do I tell them when they ask where I got the ore? It isn't just found by the roadside, you know.
You're a cursor, Calidus. You're creative. I'm sure you'll think of something.
Fidelius chuckled. You've learned delegating skills, at least. So, we approach this renegade legion with our precious ore.
He nodded back toward the squeaking cart.
What's to stop them from simply taking it?
You're the harbinger of a smuggling network representing several interests in the business. Your trip is being watched, and if the results are good, others might be willing to bring supplies as well.
That's what I don't understand, Fidelius said, his expression innocent. If this is indeed a renegade legion, as rumors say, under the command of one of the High Lords in preparation for overthrowing the crown, aren't they going to object to any word about them getting out? Good, bad, or indifferent?
Yes, Amara said. She glanced down at him. Which works in our favor. You see, if you don't return from this little jaunt, word is going to spread all around Alera about this encampment.
Inevitable, since word would get out anyway. One can hardly keep an entire legion secret for long.
It's our best shot, Amara said. Can you think of anything better?
We sneak in close, furycraft ourselves into the camp, obtain evidence, and then run like the crows were after us.
Oh, Amara said. I considered it. I decided it was too brainless and predictable.
It has the advantage of simplicity, Fidelius pointed out. We recover the information, give solid evidence to the Crown, and let the First Lord launch a more comprehensive anti-sedition campaign.
Yes, that's simpler. But once whoever is running this camp knows that they have been observed by the cursors, they will simply disperse and move their operations elsewhere. The Crown will simply spend money and effort and lives to pin them down again, and even then whoever is putting out the money to field their own army might simply get away. Fidelius glanced up at her and let out a low whistle.
So you want to get in and out undetected, get word to the Crown, and then what?
Lead a few cohorts of Knights Aeris back down here and crush them where they lie, Amara said. Take prisoners, have them testify against their backers, and wrap it all up right here.
Ambitious, he commented. Very ambitious. Very dangerous, too. If they catch on to us, they'll kill us. And it's reasonable to expect that they'll have knights as well, and that they'll be on the lookout for a cursor or two.
That's why we don't get caught, Amara said. We play the poor, greedy smuggler and his slave, haggle for all the money we can get from them, and leave.
And keep the money. Fidelius frowned. On general principle, I like any mission that involves a profit. But Amara, there's a lot that could go wrong with this one.
We are the First Lord's messengers, are we not? His eyes and ears?
Don't quote the Codex at me, Fidelius snapped, annoyed. I was a cursor before your mother and father had called their first furies. Don't think that because the First Lord has taken a shine to you that you know better than I do.
You don't think it's worth the risk?
I think there's a lot you don't know, Fidelius said,
and he looked very old for some reason. Uncertain.
Let me handle this, Amara. I'll go inside. You stay here and I'll pick you up on the way out. There's no reason to risk both of us.
No, she said. In the first place, this is my mission to run. In the second, you will need your full attention to play your role. I'll be able to make observations, especially from up here.
She slapped the gargant's broad back, and the bull snorted up a small whirlwind of trail dust in response.
I'll also be able to watch our backs. If I get the impression that they're onto us, we can get out of there.
Fidelius muttered, I thought we'd just use this guise to pose as travelers. Get close and slip into the camp after dark.
When no one else is coming in and when we're certain to arouse suspicion if we're seen?
He blew out a breath. All right, he said. All right. We'll do it your way. But you're gambling yourself with the crows.
Amara's stomach fluttered again and she pressed a hand to it, trying to will the fear away.
It didn't leave.
No, she said. I'm gambling both of us. Though the gargant's plodding steps seemed slow, each covered many strides of a man. The great beast's thick clawed feet ate the miles, though it stripped the bushes and trees of leaves along the way, adding to the layers of blubbery fat beneath its hide. If allowed, the humpbacked beast would wander into the richest forage and graze, but Fidelius handled it with a sure and calm hand, keeping the beast moving along the road while he marched at the quickstep beside it. A mile more, by Amara's estimation, and they had come within picket distance of the insurgent legion's camp. She tried to remind herself of her role, that of a bored slave, sleepy and tired from days of travel, but it was all she could do to keep the mounting tension from rising in her shoulders and back. What if the legion turned out to be nothing more than rumor, and her intelligence-gathering mission, so carefully outlined and planned, turned out to be a costly waste of time? Would the First Lord think less of her? Would the other cursors? It would be a paltry introduction into the ranks indeed if she stepped forth from the academy and straight into a monumental blunder. Her anxiety grew like bands of iron stretching across her shoulders and back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.